Welcome to the exciting world of engineering graphics and drawing. In this presentation, you will understand basic concepts, tools, and techniques used in engineering drawing. Engineering drawing is a technique of creating graphical representation that contains all necessary information such as dimensions, specifications, and notes, using which an abstract concept can be transformed into a real-world entity. Applications of engineering drawing are varied. For example, shipping industry, manufacturing, construction, and many more. All right, so before we actually start drawing something, let's warm up with some important concepts. So first, let's take theory of projections. The word projection means to throw forward. It is a process of plotting an object or entity on imaginary planes. Projection has two types. First is parallel projection and second is perspective projection. Each of these in turn has further subtypes. We will focus on orthographic projections where the projectors are parallel to each other and they intersect the projection plane at right angles. We will study orthographic projection in detail later. So let's take a look at important tools used in engineering drawing. Drawing paper, drawing board, drafter, T-square, compass, divider, French curves, protractor, set squares, scales, pencils, erasers. Before you start drawing, always make sure that the size of drawing paper is less than the size of the drawing board. Also make sure that paper is fixed properly with drawing pins and it is smooth without any wrinkles or folding marks. The drawing board is a plain and smooth surface used for drawing purpose. The ebonite edge of the drawing board facilitates smooth movement of T-square. The T-square, as the name suggests, is a T-shaped drawing tool. Its straight edge slides along the width of the drawing board with the help of a stop. It is useful in drawing straight lines and also serves as supporting edge for set squares while drawing inclined lines. As you already know, the compass is used for drawing circles and arcs. The divider is a little different with both legs made of steel and is used for transferring distances. Another interesting tool is French curves. They are used to draw irregular curves such as ellipses, parabolas, hyperbolas, and the like. The drafter is a very useful tool for drawing parallel lines at any given inclination. It has scale as well as protractor inbuilt. Looks like a robot, isn't it? Protractor is used to measure and lay out angles. Another tool is set squares, also known as triangles. They come in flavors of 30, 60, 90 degrees and 45, 45, 90 degrees. Alright, so we are all set to now begin understanding basic concepts of drawing, which we will cover in the next presentation.
Sheet layout. Sheet sizes. The preferred sizes of the drawing sheets recommended by the Bureau of Indian Standards, BIS, are given below as per SP 46-2003. The layout of the drawing on a drawing sheet should be done in such a manner as to make it reading easy and speedy. The figure shows an A1 size sheet layout. All dimensions are in millimeter. Margin. Margin is provided in the drawing sheet by drawing margin lines. Prints are trimmed along these lines. After trimming, the prints would be of the recommended trimmed sizes of the trimmed sheets. Border lines. Clear working space is obtained by drawing border lines as shown in the figure. More space is kept on the left-hand side for the purpose of filing or binding if necessary. When prints are to be preserved or stored in a cabinet without filing, equal space may be provided on all sides. Borders and frames. SP 46-2003 recommends the borders of 20 mm width for the sheet sizes A0 and A1 and 10 mm for the sizes A2, A3, A4 and A5. The frame shows the clear space available for the drawing purpose. Orientation mark. Four centering marks are drawn as shown in the figure to facilitate positioning of the drawing for the reproduction purpose. The orientation mark will coincide with one of centering marks which can be used for the orientation of drawing sheet on the drawing board. Grid reference system, zone system. The grid reference system is drawn on the sheet to permit easy location on the drawings such as details, alterations or additions. The rectangle of grid along the length should be referred by numerals 1, 2, 3, so on, etc. and along the width by the capital letters A, B, C, D, etc. as shown in the figure. Title block. Space for the title block must be provided in the bottom right hand corner of the drawing sheet as shown in the figure. The size of the title block as recommended by the BIS is 185 mm into 65 mm for all designations of the drawing sheets. The figure shows the simplest type of a title block. All title blocks should contain at least the particulars as shown in the table. List of parts or the bill of materials. When drawings of a number of constituent parts of an object are drawn in a single drawing sheet, a list of these parts should be placed above or beside the title block in a tabular form. It should provide the following minimum particulars for each part: part number, name or description, number of, that is quantity required, material and sometime stock size of raw material and remarks. Folding marks. Folding marks are made in the drawing sheet. They are helpful in folding of prints in proper and easy manner.
Hello and welcome back. Now that we have seen all the tools of engineering drawing, it's time to understand the drawing techniques. Let's start with drawing scales. Drawing scales allow us to draw any object to the required size on the paper. For small objects, for example a mobile phone, the drawing of the prototype can be drawn to the same size as the original, that is 1:1 on the drawing paper. Such drawings are known as full-size drawings. However, generally the prototype is either too large, for example the Eiffel Tower, or too small, for example a micro-scale motor, and we will have to scale down or scale up the dimensions of the prototype in order to represent it on the drawing paper. The representative factor RF is the ratio of drawing dimension to the actual dimension of the object. If RF is greater than 1, then the drawing is enlarged. And if it is less than 1, then the drawing is a reduced view of the same object. So, we are all set to move on for preparing our drawing paper. We have to put together layout on a paper, including margin, border, and other entities. The engineering drawings may also contain letters used for dimensioning, writing instructions, notes, titles, labels, etc. The term used for engineering drawing text is lettering. Next element is line. Lines are the predominant and the fundamental drawing element in every drawing. Various types of lines are used to represent different entities, like visible lines are used for drawing outlines of visible edges and surface lines which represent the objects. These are drawn in bold, dark and continuous lines. Hidden lines are shown with medium thick lines consisting of short dashes and are used to represent invisible edges and surface boundaries. Center lines are thin lines drawn with alternate long dashes and dots and are used for representing symmetrical objects. Then there are dimension lines, extension lines and cutting plane lines. Well, now it's time to give exact dimensions to our drawings. Dimensioning plays a very important role while drawing. There are many types of dimensioning, such as horizontal dimensioning, vertical dimensioning, aligned dimensioning, chain or continuous dimensioning, parallel dimensioning, diameter dimensioning for circles, radius dimensioning for arcs, angular dimensioning for angles. And that's it. So with this, we have covered all necessary fundamentals of engineering drawing and graphics. Feel free to rewind and revise as you need. And of course, happy drawing.
Problem 5-5. To draw perpendicular to a given line from a point outside it. When the point is nearer the center than the end of the line, let AB be the given line and P the point. Using compass and with P as center, draw an arc of any radius R1, cutting the line AB at points C and D. With points C and D as centers and with a larger radius R2, which is greater than R1, draw arcs to cut on the side of the line AB on which perpendicular is to be drawn. The arcs intersect at point E. Now, join points E and P. Line EP may be extended to meet the line AB at point Q. Line EPQ will be perpendicular to line AB. Verify the angle AQP or BQP using a protractor. The angle AQP or BQP is the required perpendicular.
Now we will take a look at how to divide line into 7 equal parts. First, consider line AB of any length and draw line AC making an angle of less than 30 degrees with AB. With the help of dividers, mark 7 equal parts of any suitable length on line AC and mark them by points 1', 2', 3', 4', 5', 6' and 7'. Join point 7' with point B of the line AB and draw lines parallel to 7' B, cutting the line AB at 6, 5, 4, 3, 2 and 1 respectively. Now observe, the line AB has been divided into 7 equal parts. So let's move on to divide a circle of radius R into 12 equal parts. First, draw two diagonals AB and CD at right angles to each other. With A as center and radius equal to R, draw arcs cutting the circle at two points 2 and 7. Similarly, with B as center, draw arcs cutting the circle at points 3 and 6. Now repeat the above steps for points C and D to get the intersection points 1 and 4 and 5 and 8 respectively. That's it. You see, we have just divided the circle into 12 equal parts.
To trisect a given right angle. Let ABC be the given right angle. With center B and any radius, draw an arc cutting AB at D and BC at E. With the same radius and centers D and E, draw arcs cutting the arc DE at points Q and P. Draw lines joining B with P and Q. BP and BQ trisect the right angle ABC. Thus, angle ABP equals angle PBQ equals angle QBC equals 1 by 3 angle ABC.
Let's now move further to ogee-shaped arc tangent between two parallel lines. But first, what is an ogee curve? Ogee curve is also known as reverse curve and is a combination of two arcs that are reverse of each other. Now, AB and CD are the two given parallel lines. Join points B and C and bisect the line BC to obtain its center point T. Further bisect line segments BT and CT. From point B, draw a perpendicular line to cut the bisector line PQ at E. And from point C, draw a perpendicular line to cut the bisector line RS at F. With points E and F as the center points and radii equal to EB and FC, draw arcs BT and CT. The arc BTC is the required ogee curve.
Problem 5.26, to construct a regular polygon given the length of its side. Let the number of sides of the polygon be 7, that is heptagon. Method 1. Draw a line AB equal to the given length. With center A and radius AB, draw a semicircle BP. With a divider, divide the semicircle into 7 equal parts, same as the number of sides. Number the division points as 1, 2, etc., starting from P. Draw a line joining A with the second division point 2. Inscribe circle method. Draw perpendicular bisectors of A2 and AB intersecting each other at O. With center O and radius OA, describe a circle. With radius AB and starting from B, cut the circle at points C, D, etc. up to 2. Draw lines BC, CD, etc., thus completing the required heptagon. Arc method. With center B and radius AB, draw an arc cutting the line A6 produced at C. With center C and the same radius, draw an arc cutting the line A5 produced at D. Find points E and F in the same manner. Draw lines BC, CD, etc. and complete the heptagon. Method 2. General method for drawing any polygon. Draw a line AB equal to the given length. At B, draw a line BP perpendicular and equal to AB. Draw a line joining A with P. With center B and radius AB, draw the quadrant AP. Draw the perpendicular bisector of AB to intersect the straight line AP in 4 and the arc AP in 6. A square of a side equal to AB can be inscribed in the circle drawn with center 4 and radius A4. A regular hexagon of a side equal to AB can be inscribed in the circle drawn with center 6 and radius A6. The midpoint 5 of the line 4-6 is the center of the circle of the radius A5, in which a regular pentagon of side equal to AB can be inscribed. To locate center 7 for the regular heptagon of side AB, step of a division 6-7 equal to the division 5-6. With center 7 and radius equal to A7, draw a circle. Starting from B, cut it in 7 equal divisions with radius equal to AB. Draw lines BC, CD, etc. and complete the heptagon. Regular polygons of any number of sides can be drawn by this method. Let's draw a pentagon. First, we'll draw a line AB. Draw a circle with center as A and radius as AB. Similarly, draw one more circle with center as B and the radius as AB, cutting the circle 1 at C and D. Next, draw an arc with center as C and radius as AB. The arc cuts the circle 1 and circle 2 at E and F, respectively. Then, draw a perpendicular bisector of line AB, which cuts the arc EF at point G. Draw line EG long enough to cut the circle 2 at point P. Similarly, line FG is extended to cut the circle 1 at point R. After that, with P and R as centers and AB as radius, draw two arcs intersecting each other at point Q. Finally, let's draw lines connecting these points to complete the pentagon. Fine, let's study a simple method for constructing a regular octagon. The method involves inscribing a regular octagon in a given square. Consider the given square ABCD. Now we'll draw the diagonals AC and BD intersecting each other at O. Then, with A as center and AO as radius, draw an arc cutting edges AB and AD at point 2 and 7 respectively. Similarly, with centers as B, C and D and radius as AO, draw arcs to obtain remaining points. At last, we'll join the points 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8, 1, thus completing the octagon. General method of construction of an ellipse. Problem 6.1. To construct an ellipse when the distance of the focus from the directrix is equal to 50 mm and eccentricity is 2 by 3. Draw any vertical line AB as directrix. At any point C on it, draw the axis perpendicular to the AB directrix. Mark a focus F on the axis such that CF equals 50 mm. Divide CF into 5 equal divisions. Sum of numerator and denominator of the eccentricity. Mark the vertex V on the third division point from C. Thus, eccentricity E is equal to VF upon VC equals to 2 by 3. Let us now construct a scale on the axis which will directly give the distances in the required ratio. So, at V, draw a perpendicular VE equal to VF. Draw a line joining C and E. Thus, in triangle CVE, VE upon VC equals VF upon VC equals 2 by 3. Mark any point 1 on the axis and through it draw a perpendicular to meet CE produced at 1 dash. With center F and radius equal to 1, 1 dash, draw arcs to intersect the perpendicular through 1 at points P1 and P dash 1. These are the points on the ellipse because the distance of P1 from AB is equal to C1. P1F equals 1, 1 dash. And 1, 1 dash upon C1 equals VF upon VC equals 2 by 3. Similarly, mark points 2, 3, etc. on the axis and obtain points P2 and P-2, P3 and P-3, etc. Draw the ellipse through these points. It is a closed curve having two foci and two directrices. Concentric circles method to draw an ellipse. Draw the major axis AB and the minor axis CD intersecting each other at O. With center O and diameters AB and CD respectively, draw two circles. Divide the major axis circle into a number of equal divisions, say 12, and mark points 1, 2, etc. as shown in the figure. Draw lines joining these points with the center O and cutting the minor axis circle at points 1 dash, 2 dash, etc. Through the point 1 on the major axis circle, draw a line parallel to CD, the minor axis. Through point 1 dash on the minor axis circle, draw a line parallel to AB, the major axis. The point P1 where these two lines intersect is on the required ellipse. Repeat the construction through all the points. Draw the ellipse through A, P1, P2, etc. Problem 6.8. To construct a parabola when the distance of the focus from the directrix is 50 mm. Draw the directrix AB and the axis CD. Mark focus F on CD 50 mm from C. Bisect CF in V, the vertex, because eccentricity equals 1. Mark a number of points 1, 2, 3, etc. on the axis and through them draw perpendiculars to it. With center F and radius equal to C1, draw arcs cutting the perpendicular through 1 at P1 and P-1. Similarly, locate points P2 and P-2, P3 and P-3, etc. on both the sides of the axis. Draw a smooth curve through these points. This curve is the required parabola. It is an open curve. Problem 7.6. In a slider crank mechanism, the connecting rod AB is 750 mm long and the crank OA is 150 mm long. The end B moves along a straight line passing through O. Trace the locus of a point P 300 mm from A along the rod for one revolution of OA. The slider crank mechanism. This mechanism is explained as follows. The end A of the connecting rod AB is connected to the crank OA, which rotates about O. The other end B is attached to a slider which slides along a straight line. The locus of A will be a circle and that of the end B will be a straight line. The locus of any other point, say P, on the connecting rod will be neither a circle nor a straight line and can be determined by the following steps. 1. By assuming various positions of the crank end A. 2. By obtaining the corresponding positions of the end B. And 3. By locating the position of P on the lines joining the first two positions. Finally, a smooth curve drawn through the located points will be the locus of P. The curve obtained is known as coupler curves. Let's see the stepwise procedure to draw the above path. First, draw a circle which is the path of point A. Then, divide circle into 12 equal parts. From the center of the circle O, draw center line which passes the end point B of the rod. With center 1 and radius AB, cut the path of B at point B1. Draw a line joining 1 and B1. Here, we have to trace the locus of the point P on the rod at a distance from point A. Now, again with center 1 and radius PA, cut the line 1B1 at point P1. Obtain other point in similar manner. Then, draw a smooth curve through these points. This curve is the locus of point P. Observe that the distance B1-B7 is the travel of the slider and is equal to twice the length of the crank. This length is known as stroke length. Note the movement of slider is not uniform with that of the crank end A. This completes the procedure to obtain the required locus of any given point using slider crank mechanism. Problem 7.7. In the offset crank mechanism, the slider end B moves in guides along the line CD, 225 mm below the axis O of the crankshaft, plot the locus of a point P 450 mm from A along AB and of a point Q along the extension of the rod 300 mm beyond B. Determine also the travel of the slider. In this example, we shall discuss the other type of mechanism, which is offset crank mechanism. The initial procedure is same like the above example. First, divide the path of A, that is circle, into 12 equal parts. Then obtain the positions of the end B on its path. Similarly, obtain the positions of point P as shown in the above example. Here we can trace the locus of the point P. Now, offset the point B downwards from its original position. Now draw the center line CD from this point of offset. Now draw lines 1B, 2B, so on up to 12B. And mark positions Q1, Q2 up to Q12. It is also necessary to determine the limiting position of the end B. These are found by drawing arcs with center O, radii AB minus AO and AB plus AO, and cutting the path of B at point B dash and B double dash. Then draw B dash O and extend it further, which gives point Q dash. Similarly, draw B double dash O to obtain the point Q double dash. These are the limiting positions of point Q. Joining the points obtained gives the path that is the locus of point Q. Now extend the line B dash O to obtain A dash and B double dash O to obtain A double dash. These are the limiting positions of end A. A dash and A double dash will be on the lines B dash O produced and O double dash respectively. Observe that the travel of the slider is shown by the distance B double dash B dash. So friends, in this session, we learn the simple slider crank mechanism.
Problem 7.12. The end A of a rod AB rotates about O while the end B slides along a straight line. A crank CQ oscillates about Q. Draw the locus of the midpoint P of the connecting link CD for one revolution of the crank OA. AB equals 1500 mm, CD equals 750 mm, OA equals 450 mm and CQ equals 1200 mm.
Divide the circle in 12 equal parts and number the path. Extend the center line 1O such that it passes through the end B of the rod. Then draw lines of size equal to AB from all 12 points of the circle up to line OB. We will determine the various positions of point D as follows. Point D from the end A. Now, take the same distance from point 1 on the circle and mark point D1 on the line 1O. Similarly, mark point D2 to D12 on their respective lines. The point Q
from the extended line passing through the end B. Observe that the distance CQ is given. To determine the path of point C, draw an arc with radius and taking center as Q. Now, with centers D1, D2, etc. and radius CD equals, draw arcs cutting the above path of C at points C1, C2, etc. Next, locate the midpoints of lines D1, C1, D2, C2, etc. and call them as D1, D2, etc. The required locus of the midpoint P is obtained by drawing a curve through these midpoints. Thus, we can determine the locus of a midpoint of a link in the 4-bar mechanism. This L-shaped solid object is lying in the first quadrant. We'll see how to draw its front, top, and side orthogonal views. So, first draw a horizontal reference line XY. Then, a rectangle is drawn above XY line. Next, draw a line at a height of 8 units. The rectangle 1, 2, 4, 3 is the front view of the horizontal L-shaped stem of the object. This is the front orthogonal view of the object. Now, let's construct the top view. As we can see, it is a rectangle of dimensions L by W. We extend vertical projectors below line XY. Then a line 9-10 is drawn below and parallel to the reference line XY. Next, draw the lines 9-3 and 10-4 equal to the length L and join line 3-4. This rectangle is the required top view. Now, the object is viewed from the left side. So, we can see the L-shaped image on the auxiliary plane. This view appears adjacent and to the right of front view. First, draw a vertical reference line MN, which intersects the line XY at point P. From point P, a construction line is drawn, inclined at 45 degrees in the fourth quadrant. This line is used for transferring distances across different views. Now, draw projectors from the corner points of the top view to meet this inclined line at 10-, 12-, and 4-. Next, from front view, draw horizontal projectors parallel to the line XY. From points 10-, 12-, and 4-, vertical projectors are drawn upwards to meet these horizontal projectors. Join intersecting points to form the side view. This is the complete set of orthogonal views of this object. Finally, draw the first angle projection symbol at the right bottom corner. My friends, let's now create orthogonal views of this machine bracket as seen in the direction of the arrow. So, draw a horizontal reference line XY. Observe
From front side, the bracket appears to be a rectangular slot of size 100 mm by 70 mm and its thickness is 15 mm each on the each side. Now, on the top of this rectangular slot, there is a hollow cylindrical block of diameter 60 mm which appears as a rectangle of 60 mm by 20 mm. The cylindrical block has inner diameter. There is a through hole of diameter 30 mm. These parts are shown with dotted lines as they are hidden in front view. So this completes the front view of the bracket. Now, to construct the top view, project all details from front view below reference line XY. Draw a vertical center line from the center of the rectangular slot. The top view of the rectangular slot appears as a rectangle of size 100 mm by 80 mm. Here, we can clearly see the holes in the center of the rectangle. These holes are drawn taking the common center point on vertical center line. The two holes on the fillets are not visible, so they are projected as dotted lines. This completes the top view of the bracket. So let's draw the side view by projecting the details from front view and top views. Don't forget to give necessary dimensions. So that was simple, wasn't it? Now you know all the necessary techniques and theory behind orthogonal views of objects.
Hello. Today, we will generate front view, top view, and left-hand side view of this object as seen in direction X. As the first step, we will draw the bounding box of this object and determine bounding rectangles of projections in their respective plates. Observe primary parts of this object: base plate with spot holes, semi-cylindrical extrusion, boss hole, rib, and slotted vertical plate. Now, let us start with the front view, and we will first draw the rectangle for the base plate, 170 mm by 15 mm. Then, draw three vertical center lines at a distance of 20 mm, 75 mm, and 40 mm. from the left side. As next step, we will project spot face holes. Observe, each hole has two parts with different diameters. Draw hidden lines for the upper part with 30 mm diameter and it is 5 mm deep. The lower part has diameter of 15 mm. Now, let's project semi-cylindrical extrusion. To determine its center, draw horizontal center line 35 mm above the ground. Let us take cross-section of this line with third center line and draw a circle of radius 10 mm and semicircle of radius 20 mm. Now complete this extruded part. Next, draw horizontal center line parallel to previous line at a distance of 60 mm upside. Use the crossing point of this horizontal line with the third vertical center line as a center of boss circle. Draw inner circle of diameter 10 mm and outer circle of 25 mm. And don't forget the connecting rib. In next step, draw inclined line with 30 degree angle with respect to the third vertical center line. taking radius as 50 mm plus 7 mm plus 8 mm, draw semicircular center line that intersects with both the center lines. Now, quickly close the end caps of the slot. They have radii of 8 mm inside and 15 mm outside. Now, let's go to the rounded corner of vertical plate. It has a radius of 20 mm. Join it with a tangent line that extends till the base plate. As a last step of front view, draw inclined rib at 15 degree angle and connecting the slot. So here is the complete front view. Let us now move to the top view. We see the bounding rectangle here. Next, draw three vertical center lines at 20 mm, 75 mm and 40 mm respectively from left. Also, draw a horizontal center line at 20 mm above the base. Note the intersection points of this line with vertical center lines. Using these intersection points, draw two spot face holes with 30 mm diameter of outside circle and 15 mm diameter of inside circle. Now, for inclined rib and slot, take reference from the front view. The inclined rib is 10 mm thick and slot portion is 15 mm thick. Next, project semi-cylindrical extrusion. It is represented as a rectangle of 35 mm by 40 mm. Don't forget hidden lines for the 20 mm hole in it. Observe this acute overlap of slot with this semi-cylindrical portion as seen in the top view. Then project boss hole as a rectangle of 25 mm by 5 mm and draw hidden lines for 10 mm diameter hole in it. Finally, draw projection for the connecting rib. Alright, so let us now move to the left hand side view. First, extend details of base plate from front view and top view. Include lines of spot face holes as well. Next, extend inclined rib and slotted vertical plate from front view and top view. Include through slot as well. Also, take center line of boss hole from front view and generate bossing with its inside hole with hidden lines. Now, extend semi-cylindrical extrusion from front view and top view. Don't forget its hole that is throughout the vertical plate. The last remaining part of this object is the connecting rib. Draw inclined line for it. And here we go. So let's show all the necessary dimensions in all the views to complete this solution.
Hi friends, let's start with actual construction of orthogonal projections of points, lines and planes. First, we'll study the projection of simplest geometrical element as a point. So, let's start with an example. Here, a point object A is located in the first quadrant at a height of h units above HP and distance of d units in front of VP. An observer is looking at the point in the direction of the arrow. The front view will be a point A dash on VP and its top view will be A on HP obtained by projectors drawn from the given point A. So, let's draw this projection onto a paper considering the HP is rotated in the clockwise direction by 90 degrees so that it becomes coplanar with the VP. For this, draw a horizontal reference line XY. Mark a point C anywhere on line XY. From point C, mark a point A dash at a distance of h units above line XY and point A at a distance d units below line XY in line with A dash. Here, A and A dash represent the images of the object on VP and HP respectively, and the line joining AA dash is the projector line and is perpendicular to the reference line XY. Now, let's see what will be the projection of a point in the third quadrant. Observe, the point object A is in the third quadrant at a height of H units below the HP and a distance of D units behind the VP. Then, the front view point A will be a point A dash on VP and its top view will be a point A on HP. So friends, now we have seen the visualization of the point. Let's see its construction. We'll repeat the step of drawing a horizontal reference line XY. Then mark a point C anywhere on the line XY. From point C, mark a point A dash at a distance of H units below line XY and point A at a distance of D units above line XY. The points A and A dash represent the images of the object on VP and HP respectively. The line joining AA dash is the projector line and is perpendicular to the reference line XY. Observe, its front view will be lying below XY and top view will be above XY. Now, look at the screen carefully. This is a special case in which point object R is lying within the vertical plane of the projection VP and above HP. Its front view R will be coinciding with the point object itself and will be located above the reference line XY. Its top view R dash lies on the reference line XY. Similarly, if a point, say A, is lying within the horizontal plane of projection in front of VP, observe its top view A dash and front view A. So friends, now you have got acquainted with the concept of projection of a point in the first and third quadrant. And in the next session, we'll continue similar discussion for lines and planes. A straight line AB is perpendicular to HP and parallel to VP, where the point A is H units above HP and point B is D units in front of VP. Observe the front view of line AB as line A dash B dash. As you can see from top, point B is visible and it hides point A. So, projectors from point B passing through A meets HP at point BA, which is the top view. So, Let's see how it will appear on paper. For this, first draw a horizontal reference line XY. Then draw a line A'B' above and perpendicular to XY with endpoint A' at a distance of 8 units from XY. Next, mark a point BA below XY at a distance of D units in line with line A'B'. Line A'B' and point BA are the projections of the line AB on BP and HP respectively.
Line inclined to one plane and parallel to the other. The inclination of a line to a plane is the angle which the line makes with its projection on that plane. Line PQ1 is inclined at an angle theta to the HP and is parallel to the VP. The inclination is shown by the angle theta which PQ1 makes with its own projection on the HP, that is the top view PQ1. The projections may be drawn by first assuming the line to be parallel to both the HP and the VP. Its front view P'Q' and the top view PQ will both be parallel to XY and equal to the true length. When the line is turned about the end P to the position PQ1 so that it makes the angle theta with the HP while remaining parallel to the VP. In the front view, the point Q' will move along an arc drawn with P' as center and P'Q' as the radius to a point Q'1 so that P'Q'1 makes an angle theta with XY. In the top view, Q will move towards P along PQ to a point Q1 on the projector through Q'1. P'Q'1 and PQ1 are the front view and the top view respectively of the line PQ1. Line RS1 is inclined at an angle phi to the VP and it's parallel to the HP. The inclination is shown by the angle phi which RS1 makes with its projection on the VP, that is the front view R'H'1. Assuming the line to be parallel to both the HP and the VP, its projections R'H' and RS are drawn parallel to XY and equal to its true length. When the line is turned about its end R to the position RS1 so that it makes the angle phi with the VP while remaining parallel to the HP, in the top view, the point S will move along an arc drawn with R as center and RS as radius to a point S1 so that RS1 makes the angle phi with XY. In the front view, the point S' will move towards R' along the line R'S' to a point S'1 on the projector through S1. RS1 and R'S'1 are the projections of the line RS1. Therefore, when the line is inclined to the HP and parallel to the VP, its top view is shorter than its true length, but parallel to XY. Its front view is equal to the true length and is inclined to XY at its true inclination with the HP. And when the line is inclined to the VP and parallel to the HP, its front view is shorter than its true length, but parallel to XY. Its top view is equal to its true length and is inclined to XY at its true inclination with the VP. Hence, when a line is inclined to one plane and parallel to the other, its projection on the plane to which it is inclined is a line shorter than its true length, but parallel to the reference line. Its projection on the plane to which it is parallel is a line equal to its true length and inclined to the reference line at its true inclination. In other words, the inclination of a line with the HP is seen in the front view and that with the VP is seen in the top view. Let's move further discussing a case where the line AB is inclined to both HP and VP and its projection will be shorter in length compared to its actual length. Look at the diagram. Here, line AB is assumed to be parallel to VP but inclined to HP by the angle 45 degrees. Observe its front view A'B'1 on VP gives the true length and the inclination with XY. The top view is a shorter line AB1 parallel to XY. Now, the opposite case. The line AB is assumed to be parallel to HP and inclined to VP by the angle 30 degrees. Observe line AB2 is the top view making an angle 30 degrees with VP. Since the line is now assumed to be parallel to HP, its front view is a line A'B'2 parallel to XY. At last, to rotate the line A'B'2 to the final position, draw the locus of the end point B in front and top views. Locus of the point B' is a line passing through B'1 and parallel to XY. With A' as center and A'B'2 as radius, draw an arc cutting the locus line of B'1 at B'. The line A'B' is the required front view of the given line. Now, similarly, with A as center and AB1, draw an arc cutting the locus line B2 at B. The line AB will be the top view of the given line. Well, this completes the discussion about the projections of the straight line.
Projection of a point on an auxiliary plane. 1. Projection of a point on an auxiliary vertical plane. A point A is situated in front of the VP and above the HP. AVP is the auxiliary vertical plane inclined at an angle alpha to the VP. The HP and the AVP meet at right angles in the line X1, Y1. A' and A are respectively the front view and the top view of the point A. A'1 is the auxiliary front view obtained by drawing a projection AA'1 perpendicular to the AVP. It can be clearly seen that A'1, O1, the distance of the auxiliary front view A'1 from X1, Y1 is equal to A'O. The distance of the front view A' from XY is equal to AA, the distance of the point A from the HP. The figure shows the VP and the AVP rotated about the HP to which they are perpendicular.
The line of intersection x1, y1 between the AVP and the HP is inclined at the angles alpha to xy. The line joining the top view A with the auxiliary front view A'1 is at right angles to x1, y1 and intersects it at O1. Note that A'1, O1 is equal to A'O. To draw the orthographic views, start with the reference line XY and mark the front view A' and the top view A. Draw a new reference line x1, y1 making the angle alpha with xy. Through the top view A, draw a projector AA'1 perpendicular to and intersecting x1, y1 at O1 and such that A'1, O1 is equal to A'O. A'1 is the required auxiliary front view. The new reference line making the angle alpha with xy can be drawn in four different positions as shown in the figure by lines x1, y1, x2, y2, etc. All the front views are projected from the top view A and their distance from their respective reference lines are equal. That is, A'1O1 is equal to A'2O2, so on, is equal to A'O. Projection of a point on an auxiliary inclined plane. A point P is situated above the HP and in front of the VP. AIP is an auxiliary inclined plane making an angle beta with the HP. It meets the VP at right angles and in a line x1, y1. P' and P are respectively the front view and the top view of the point P. P1 is the auxiliary top view obtained by drawing the projector PP1 perpendicular to the AIP. It can be seen that P1, O1, the distance of the auxiliary top view P1 from X1, Y1 is equal to PO. The distance of the top view P from XY is equal to PP', the distance of the point P from the VP. The HP and the AIP are then rotated about the VP to which they are perpendicular. X1, Y1, the line of intersection between the VP and the AIP makes the angle beta with XY. The line joining the front view P' and the auxiliary top view P1 is at right angles to X1, Y1 and intersects it at O1. Note that P1, O1 is equal to PO. To draw the orthographic views, draw X, Y and mark P' and P. Draw X1, Y1 making the angle beta with XY. Through the front view P', draw a projector P'P1 perpendicular to and intersecting X1, Y1 at O1 and such that P1, O1 is equal to PO. P1 is the required auxiliary front view. In this case also, the new reference line can be drawn in four different positions as shown in the figure by lines X1, Y1, X2, Y2, etc. Each inclined at beta to XY. All the top views are projected from the front view P' and their distances from their respective reference lines are equal. That is, P1, O1 is equal to P2, O2, so on equals PO. If the inclination of the AVP with the VP is increased so that alpha equals 90 degrees, the AVP will be perpendicular to both the planes. Similarly, if the inclination of the AIP with the HP is increased so that beta equals 90 degrees, it will also be perpendicular to both the HP and the VP. This plane is also called the profile plane PP. It may be rotated about any one of the two principal planes. The view on this plane can therefore be projected from either the top view or the front view and named accordingly. Projection of a point on an auxiliary plane perpendicular to both the principal planes. In the figure, A is a point, PP is an auxiliary plane perpendicular to the HP, and the VP, A1, is the auxiliary view projected on the PP. It can be seen that A1O2 is equal to A-O is equal to AA, the distance of A from the HP. Also, A1O1 is equal to AO is equal to AA-, the distance of A from the VP. The figure shows the PP rotated about the VP. A1 lies on the projector drawn through the front view A- and perpendicular to the line of intersection between the VP and the PP. It is thus projected from the front view and hence called the auxiliary top view. In technical drawings, this view is generally termed as the side view, end view or end front view. Note that A1O1 is equal to AO. Note that when seen from the left, the new reference line and the side view are placed to the right of the front view. When seen from the right, they would be placed to the left of the front view. Thus, the view seen from any side of the front view is placed on its other side. The figure shows the PP rotated about the HP. The view on the PP now lies on the projector drawn through the top view A. Hence, it is called the auxiliary front view. In this case, A-1O2 is equal to A-O. The orthographic views in both these cases are self-explanatory. To determine true shape of a plane figure, problem 11.8. Projections of a pentagon resting on the ground on one of its sides are given. Determine the true shape of the pentagon. AA is the true length of the side because it is parallel to the HP. Draw a reference line X1, Y1 perpendicular to AE. Project an auxiliary front view on it. It will give a point view A-1 and E-1 of AE and an edge view A-1, C-1 of the pentagon. Draw another reference line X2, Y2 parallel to A-1, C-1 and project an auxiliary top view A1, B1, C1, D1, E1, which will be the true shape of the pentagon.
Projections of a plane. Problem 12.7. A rectangular plane surface of size L into W is positioned in the first quadrant and is inclined at an angle of 60 degrees with the HP and 30 degrees with the VP. Draw its projections.
The plane is first assumed to be parallel to HP with its shorter edge perpendicular to the VP. In this position, true shape and size of the plane is given by its projection on HP. The front view will be a true line parallel to the reference line XY. Rotate the front view projection by 60 degrees, the angle of inclination of plane with HP. Draw vertical lines from the ends of line A'D' and B'C' to intersect horizontal lines drawn from the top view ABCD at points B1, C1, D1 and A1. Join A1, B1, C1, D1 to obtain the top view of the plane in this inclined position. Now, rotate the edge D1, C1 of the top view by 30 degrees, the angle of inclination of plane with VP, and reproduce it as shown. Draw projections from A1, B1, C1 and D1 to intersect the horizontal projections from A'D' and B'C' to get the points A'1, B'1, C'1 and D'1. Join the lines A'1, B'1, C'1, D'1 to obtain the final front view of the given plane surface. Projections of solids. Types of solids. Solids may be divided into two main groups. 1. Polyhedra and 2. Solids of revolution. Polyhedra. A polyhedron is defined as a solid bound by planes called faces. When all the faces are equal and regular, the polyhedron is said to be regular. There are 7 regular polyhedra which may be defined as stated below. 1. Tetrahedron. It has 4 equal faces, each an equilateral triangle. 2. Cube or hexahedron. It has 6 faces, all equal squares. 3. Octahedron. It has 8 equal equilateral triangles as faces. 4. Dodecahedron. It has 12 equal and regular pentagons as faces. 5. Icosahedron. It has 20 faces, all equal equilateral triangles. 6. Prism. This is a polyhedron having 2 equal and similar faces called its ends or bases, parallel to each other and joined by other faces which are parallelograms. The imaginary line joining the centers of the bases is called the axis. A right regular prism has its axis perpendicular to the bases. All its faces are equal rectangles. 7. Pyramid. This is a polyhedron having a plane figure as a base and a number of triangular faces meeting at a point called the vertex or apex. The imaginary line joining the apex with the center of the base is its axis. A right regular pyramid has its axis perpendicular to the base, which is a regular plane figure. Its faces are all equal isosceles triangles. Oblique prisms and pyramids have their axis inclined to their bases. Prisms and pyramids are named according to the shape of their bases, as triangular, square, pentagonal, hexagonal, etc. Solids of revolution. Cylinder. A right circular cylinder is a solid generated by the revolution of a rectangle about one of its sides, which remains fixed. It has two equal circular bases. The line joining the centers of the bases is the axis. It is perpendicular to the bases. Cone. A right circular cone is a solid generated by the revolution of a right angled triangle about one of its perpendicular sides, which is fixed. It has one circular base. Its axis joins the apex with the center of the base to which it is perpendicular. Straight lines drawn from the apex to the circumference of the base circle are all equal and are called generators of the cone. The length of the generator is the slant height of the cone. Sphere. A sphere is a solid generated by the revolution of a semicircle about its diameter as the axis. The midpoint of the diameter is the center of the sphere. All points on the surface of the sphere are equidistant from its center. Oblique cylinders and cones have their axis inclined to their bases. Frustum. When a pyramid or a cone is cut by a plane parallel to its base, thus removing the top portion, the remaining portion is called its frustum. Truncated. When a solid is cut by a plane inclined to the base, it is said to be truncated.
Hi friends, now we shall discuss projections of solids with a special case, that is, axis inclined to one of the reference planes and parallel to the other. To solve such problems, alteration of position method is used. In that, initially the axis of the solid is assumed to be perpendicular to one of the planes. Then, view showing its true shape and size is drawn. Next, other views are constructed by projecting the details from the first view. And finally, position of one of the views is altered as per requirements and remaining views are generated once again. To understand this method, let's solve a problem. A pentagonal prism has base side length of 25 mm and axis length of 50 mm. It is resting on one of its rectangular faces on HP. The axis is inclined at 45 degrees to the VP. Now to draw the orthogonal views in this position, we shall assume that its axis is perpendicular to VP. Observe that the true shape and size of the pentagonal prism is seen in the front view. We shall generate pentagon in the front view with base parallel to XY. Then let's construct the top view by projecting the details from the front view. Now we will follow the procedure to alter the position of the top view. First, let's draw the axis line at 45 degrees to XY and adjacent to the existing top view. The axis length is 50 mm. Then draw a perpendicular line x1 y1 passing through this axis. Next, we shall draw a line x2 y2 parallel to x1 y1 at a distance of 50 mm. Use a divider to measure the distances of the corner points from the existing top view and mark them respectively in this new inclined top view. Finally, connect all points in proper sequence. Here, observe that the hidden lines are shown in dotted pattern. Then project all points from this top view above line XY. These projectors will intersect the horizontal projectors drawn from the existing front view. mark the intersecting points and complete front view in this altered position. Observe the hidden lines are shown as dashed lines coincide with other visible lines. And here we have a complete solution of all the views. So friends, these are basic steps in constructing the views when axis of the solid is inclined to one of the reference planes.
Projections of solids, problem 13.22. A hexagonal pyramid, base 25 mm side and axis 55 mm long has one of its slant edges on the ground. A plane containing that edge and the axis is perpendicular to the HP and inclined at 45 degrees to the VP. Draw its projections when the apex is nearer the VP than the base. Assume the pyramid to be resting on the ground on its base with a slant edge parallel to the VP. Draw the top view of the pyramid with a side of the hexagon parallel to XY. The lines AO and DO for the slant edges will also be parallel to XY. Project the front view. Tilt this front view so that A'O' or D'O' is in XY. Project the second top view. Draw a new reference line X1Y1 making 45 degrees angle with O1D1, the top view of the axis, and project the final front view. The problem is thus solved by combination of the change of position and change of reference line methods.
Sections of cylinders. Section plane inclined to the base. Problem 14.17. A cylinder of 40 mm diameter, 60 mm height and having its axis vertical is cut by a section plane perpendicular to the VP, inclined at 45 degrees to the HP and intersecting the axis 32 mm above the base. Draw its front view, sectional top view, sectional side view and true shape of the section. As the cylinder has no edges, a number of lines representing the generators may be assumed on its curved surface by dividing the base circle into, say, 12 equal parts. Name the points at which these lines are cut by the VT. In the top view, these points lie on the circle and hence the same circle is the top view of the section. The width of the section at any point, say C dash, will be equal to the length of the chord CC1 in the top view. The true shape of the section may be drawn around the center line AG drawn parallel to VT as shown. It is an ellipse, the major axis of which is equal to the length of the section plane, that is A'G', and the minor axis equal to the diameter of the cylinder, that is DD1. Project the sectional side view as shown. The section will be seen as a circle because the section plane makes 45 degrees angle with XY. Sections of cones. Section plane inclined to the base of the cone at an angle greater than the angle of inclination of the generators with the base. Problem 14.26. A cone, base 45 mm diameter and axis 55 mm long is resting on the HP on its base.
It is cut by a section plane perpendicular to both the HP and the VP and 6 mm away from the axis. Draw its front view, top view and sectional side view. The section will be seen as a line perpendicular to XY in both the front view and the top view. The side view will show the true shape of the section. The width of the section at any point, say C dash, will be equal to CC1 obtained by the circle method. Draw the side view of the cone. Project the points on the section in the side view, taking the widths from the top view. For example, through C dash, draw a horizontal line. Mark on it points C double dash and C double dash 1 equidistant from and on both sides of the axis so that C double dash C double dash 1 equals CC1. Draw a curve through the points thus obtained. It will be a hyperbola. Methods of development of surfaces. The following are the principal methods of development of surfaces. 1. Parallel line development. It is employed in case of prisms and cylinders in which stretch out line principle is used. Lines AA and A1A1 in the figure are called the stretch out lines. 2. Radial line development. It is used for pyramids and cones in which the true length of the slant edge or the generator is used as radius. 3. Triangulation development. This is used to develop transition pieces. This is simply a method of dividing a surface into a number of triangles and transferring them into the development. Approximate method. It is used to develop objects of double curved or warped surfaces as sphere, paraboloid, ellipsoid, hyperboloid, and helicoid. As an example, let us develop the surface of a sphere. The surface of a sphere can be approximately developed by dividing it into a number of parts. The division may be made in two different ways. 1. In zones and 2. In lunes. Zone is the portion of the sphere enclosed between two planes perpendicular to the axis. Divide top half of a sphere into four zones of A, B, C and D of equal width W in front view. Project these zones on top view. Each zone becomes a cone frustum, except the uppermost zone A, which becomes a cone of small altitude. Development of these zones A, B, C and D will give the development of the half sphere. Let us carry out the development of zone C. Divide the zone C into 12 equal parts in top view. Label them from 1 to 12 and 1 dash to 12 dash respectively. Join Q and R and extend this line to intersect at C1 with vertical center line. Similarly, join 7 and 7 dash and extend up to C1. Now, Zone C is the frustum of cone C1, Q7. With C1 as center and C1, 7' as radius, draw an arc A1. Similarly, with C1 as center and C7 as radius, draw an arc A2. Divide the arc A2 into 12 equal parts such that the length of each part is taken from top view. That is, length 7-8 in top view equals length 7-8 in front view. Length 8-9 in top view equals length 8-9 in front view, and so on. Similarly, divide the arc A1 into 12 equal parts such that the length of each part is taken from top view. That is, length 7-8 in top view equals length 7-8 in front view. Length 8-9 in top view equals length 8-9 in front view, and so on. Hence, the portion between two arcs is the development of zone C. Similarly, complete the development of zone A, B and D. Division in lunes. Loon is the portion between two planes which contains the axis of the sphere. For development, let us divide sphere into 12 loons as shown in 3D view. Similarly, divide the sphere in front view into 12 loons. Select one loon as shown with shaded portion for development. The shaded semicircle QR is the top view of the loon. Divide the semicircle QR of top view into 8 equal parts and label them from 1 to 7. Project the division points of top view on front view to get 1', 2', 3', 4', 5', 6', 7' points on horizontal center line. With Q' as center and radii equal to Q'1', Q'2', and Q'3', draw arcs AB, CD and EF which will show the width of the loon at points 1 and 7, 2 and 6 and 3 and 5 respectively. Draw a line QR in line of horizontal center line and divide line QR into 8 equal parts by taking length of each part from top view. That is, length Q1 on top view equals length Q1 on line QR. Length 1-2 on top view equals length 1-2 on line QR. Length 2-3 on top view equals length 2-3 on line QR, so on. Length 7R on top view equals length 7R on line QR respectively. Draw perpendiculars from points 1 to 7 on line QR. Draw horizontal lines from A and B in front view to cut perpendicular drawn at point 1 of line QR at points A and B respectively. Similarly, draw horizontal lines from C and D in front view to cut perpendicular drawn at point 2 of line QR at points C and D respectively. Similarly, draw horizontal lines from E and F in front view to cut perpendicular drawn at point 3 of line QR at points E and F respectively. Similarly, draw horizontal lines from G and H in front view to cut perpendicular drawn at point 4 of line QR at points G and H respectively. Similarly, get points on remaining perpendicular lines. Draw smooth curve through points Q, A, C, E, G, I, K, M and R. Similarly, draw smooth curve through points Q, B, D, F, H, J, L, N and R. Thus, the figure obtained will be the approximate development of 12th portion of the surface of the sphere.
Prisms. Problem 15.3. Draw the development of a lateral surface of the part P of the pentagonal prism as shown in the figure. Name the corners of the prism and the points at which the edges are cut. Draw the development assuming the prism to be whole. It is made up of 5 equal rectangles. Draw horizontal lines through points 1', 2', etc. to cut the lines for the corresponding edges in the development at points 1, 2, etc. Draw lines joining these points and complete the development as shown.
Development of surfaces. Problem 15.22. Draw the development of the lateral surface of the truncated cone as shown in the figure. Assuming the cone to be whole, let us draw its development. First, draw the base circle in the top view and divide it into 12 equal parts. With any point O at center and radius equal to O-1' or O-7', draw an arc of the circle. The length of this arc should be equal to the circumference of the base circle. This can be determined in two ways. Calculate the subtended angle theta by the formula theta is equal to 360 degree into radius of the base circle upon slant height. Cut off the arc so that it subtends the angle theta at the center and divide it into 12 equal parts. Step off with a bow divider 12 equal divisions on the arc, each equal to one of the divisions of the base circle. Join the division points with O, thus completing the development of the whole cone with 12 generators as shown in it. The truncated portion of the cone may be deducted from this development by marking the positions of points at which generators are cut and then drawing a curve through them. For example, generators O-2' and O-12' in the front view are cut at points B' and B'1 which coincide with each other. The true length of the O-B' may be obtained by drawing a line through B' parallel to the base and cutting O-7' at B'. Then O-B' is the true length of O-B'. In last step, mark points B and B1 on generators O2 and O12 respectively, such that OB is equal to OB1 is equal to O-B'. locate all points in the same way and draw a smooth curve through them. The figure encloses this curve and the arc is the development of the truncated cone.
Hello friends. When two solids intersect or penetrate, their surfaces intersect at a common line of intersection. We must know the exact location of the intersecting line for the development of the solids. The line of intersection, also known as the transition line, it could be of any shape. It would be a straight line when solids having flat surfaces intersect. The line could be a curved line when solids having curved surfaces intersect. Or it could be a combination of straight and curved lines when one of the intersecting solids is flat and the other one is curved. How can we obtain the two representation of the line of intersection? For that, first identify key points on the surfaces of the intersecting solids. Then, draw a number of lines known as generators from key points to plot the line of intersection.
Intersection of cylinder and cylinder. Problem 16.8. A vertical cylinder of 80 mm diameter is completely penetrated by another cylinder of 60 mm diameter, their axes bisecting each other at right angles. Draw their projections showing the curves of penetration, assuming the axis of the penetrating cylinder to be parallel to the VP. Draw the front view and the top view and show lines for 12 generators in the horizontal cylinder in both views. Line method. Mark points P1, P2, etc. at which lines 1, 1, 2, 2, etc. intersect the circle showing the surface of the vertical cylinder in the top view and project them to P-1, P-2, etc. on corresponding lines 1-1, 2-2, etc. in the front view. Draw the required curves on both sides of the axis through points thus located. Hidden portions of the curves coincide with the visible portions. Points P-1, P-4, P-7 and P-10 are the key points where the curves change direction. Cutting plane method. It will be seen that in this problem, there is practically no difference between the line method and the cutting plane method. But the latter method proves more useful in solving problems in which none of the projections show a line view of the surface of a solid. Assume a series of horizontal cutting planes passing through the lines on the horizontal cylinder and cutting both the cylinders. Sections of the horizontal cylinder will be rectangles, while those of the vertical cylinder will always be circles of the same diameter as its own. Points at which sides of the rectangles intersect the circle will lie on the curve of intersection. For example, let a horizontal section plane through points 2 and 12. In the front view, it will be seen as a line coinciding with the line 2-2. The section of the horizontal cylinder will be a rectangle of width W, that is the line to 12. The section of the vertical cylinder will be a circle. Points P2 and P12 at which the sides 2-2 and 12-12 of the rectangle cut the circle lie on the curve. These points are first marked in the top view and then projected to the points P-2 and P-12 on the lines 2-2 and 12-12 in the front view. Points on the other side of the vertical axis are located in the same manner. Intersection of cone and cylinder. Problem 16.22. A vertical cone, diameter of base 75 mm and axis 100 mm long, is completely penetrated by a cylinder of 45 mm diameter. The axis of the cylinder is parallel to the HP and the VP and intersects the axis of the cone at a point 28 mm above the base. Draw the projections of the solids showing curves of intersection. Cutting plane method. Draw lines dividing the surface of the cylinder into 12 equal parts. Assume a horizontal cutting plane passing through, say, point 2. The section of the cylinder will be a rectangle of width W, while that of the cone will be a circle of diameter EE. These two sections intersect at points P2 and P12. These sections are clearly indicated in the top view by the rectangle 2, 2, 12, 12 and the circle of diameter EE. In the front view, the cutting plane is seen as a line coinciding with 2-2. Points P2 and P12, when projected on line 2-2, with which the line 12-12 coincides, will give a point P-2, with which P-12 will coincide. Then, P-2 and P-12 are the points on the curve of intersection. To obtain the points systematically, draw the circles with center O and diameters DD, EE, FF, etc., cutting the lines through 1, 2 and 12, 3 and 11, etc., at points P1, P2 and P12, P3 and P11, etc. Project these points to the corresponding lines in the front view. Two more key points at which the curve changes directions must also be located. Their positions are determined from the side view. They are the points of nearest approach, that is M-' and N-' at which the lines drawn from the center of the circle and perpendicular to the extreme generators of the cone cut the circle. Project these points to M' and N' in the front view and to M and N in the top view on the corresponding lines. Draw curves through these points in both the views. The back curve in the front view will coincide with the front curve. In the top view, a part of the curve will lie hidden and hence it will be dotted. Draw similar curves on the right-hand side of the axis of the cone. Isometric projection. Introduction. Isometric projection is a type of pictorial projection in which the three dimensions of a solid are not only shown in one view, but their actual sizes can be measured directly from it. If a cube is placed on one of its corner on the ground HP with a solid diagonal EC perpendicular to the VP, the front view is the isometric projection of the cube. The three lines CB, CD and CG meeting at C and representing the three edges of the solid right angle are also equally inclined to the VP and are therefore equally foreshortened. The diagonal BD of top face is parallel to the VP and hence retains its true length. The lines parallel to these axes are called isometric lines. That is, lines BF, DH, AE, FG, AD, EH, GH, AB and FE are called isometric lines. BF, DH and AE lines are parallel to axis CG. FG, AD and EH lines are parallel to axis BC. GH, AB and FE lines are parallel to axis CD. The six faces of the cubes are called isometric plates. These faces are seen as rhombus. The axes CB, CD and CG make equal angle of 120 degrees with each other. In isometric, the vertical line remains vertical and horizontal lines make angle of 30 degrees with horizontal as line CG remains vertical but lines CB and CD make 30 degrees angle each with horizontal. To find isometric scale, construct a square BQDP around diagonal BD. Then BP shows true length of side BA. Side BP makes 45 degrees angle with diagonal BP. In triangle ABO, BA upon BO equals 1 upon cos 30 degrees is equal to 2 upon root 3. In triangle PBO, BP upon BO equals 1 upon cos 45 degrees, which equals root 2 upon 1. Now, BA upon BP equals 2 upon root 3 into 1 upon root 2, which equals root 3 upon root 2, which equals 0.815. Therefore, BA equals 0.815 into BP. That means isometric length equals 0.815 into true length. Isometric drawing of planes or plane figures. Problem 17.1. The front view of a square is given in figure. Draw its isometric view. As the front view is a square, the surface of the square is vertical. In isometric view, vertical lines will be drawn vertical while horizontal lines will be drawn inclined at 30 degrees to the horizontal. Through any point D, draw a vertical line DA equals DA. Again, through D, draw a line DC equals DC inclined at 30 degrees to the horizontal and at 60 degrees to DA. Complete the rhombus A, B, C, D, which is the required isometric view. The view can also be drawn in direction of the other sloping axis as shown in the figure. Problem 17.2. If the given view is a top view of a square, draw its isometric view. As the top view is a square, the surface of the square is horizontal. In isometric view, all the sides will be drawn inclined at 30 degrees to the horizontal. From any point T, draw two lines DA and DC inclined at 30 degrees to the horizontal and making 120 degrees angle between themselves. Complete the rhombus ABCD, which is the required isometric view. Isometric projections. Problem 17.7. The figure shows the front view of a circle whose surface is parallel to the VP. Draw the isometric view of the circle. Method of points. Enclose the circle in a square, touching it in points 1, 2, 3 and 4. Draw the diagonals of the square cutting the circle in points 5, 6, 7 and 8. Draw the isometric view of the square and on it mark the midpoints 1, 2, 3 and 4 of its sides. Obtain points 5, 6, 7 and 8 on the diagonals as explained in the previous problem. Or, after determining the position of one point, draw through it lines parallel to the sides of the rhombus and obtain the other three points. Draw a neat and smooth curve passing through the 8 points, that is 1, 6, 2, 7, etc. The curve is the required isometric view. It is an ellipse. Problem 17.16. Draw the isometric view of the frustum of the hexagonal pyramid as shown in the figure. Enclose the front view and the top view in rectangles. Draw the isometric view of the rectangular box. Locate the 6 points of the base of the frustum on the sides of the bottom of the box. The upper 6 points on the top surface of the box are located by drawing isometric lines. For example, P1 and Q1 intersecting at a point 1. Join the corners and complete the isometric view as shown. Problem 17.17. Draw the isometric view of the pentagonal pyramid, the projections of which are given in the figure. Enclose the base in the top view in an oblong. Draw an offset OQ, that is PQ, on the line AB. Draw the isometric view of the oblong and locate the corners of the base in it. Mark a point Q on the line AB such that AQ equals AQ. From Q, draw a line QP equal to QO and parallel to 2C. At P, draw a vertical OP equal to O'P'. Join O with the corners of the base, thus completing the isometric view of the pyramid. The figure shows the isometric view of the same pyramid with its axis in horizontal position. Oblique projection. oblique drawing of prism. Problem 18.4. A hexagonal prism, base 50 mm side and axis 100 mm long, resting on its base on HP, is cut by a section plane perpendicular to VP and makes an angle of 45 degrees with the HP. It passes through a point on the axis 20 mm from its top. Draw the oblique projection of the prism by the Cavalier method with receding axis inclined at 45 degrees with the horizontal when A. Two rectangular faces of the prism are equally inclined with VP and B. One rectangular face of the prism is parallel to VP. Draw the front view and top view of the hexagonal prism as shown in the figures. Enclose the top view in rectangular box. Draw oblique projection as shown in the figures using box method as explained in problem 17.14, problem 17.15 and problem 17.16. Similarly, using the box method, draw sectional oblique projection as shown. Perspective projection. Introduction. Perspective projection or perspective drawing is the representation of an object on a plane surface called the picture plane as it would appear to the eye when viewed from a fixed position. Principle of perspective projection. In perspective projection, the eye is assumed to be situated at a definite position relative to the object. The vertical plane, which in perspective is called a picture plane, is placed between the object and the eye. Visual rays from the eye to the object converge to a point in the eye and are therefore inclined to the picture plane. The rays pierce the picture plane and form an image on it. This image is the perspective of the object. Definitions of perspective elements. Various elements used in obtaining the perspective views are defined as follows. Ground plane, GP. It is a horizontal plane on which the object is assumed to be situated. Station point, S. It is the point where the eye of the observer is located while viewing the object. Picture plane, PP. It is a vertical, transparent plane located between the station point and the object which is to be viewed. It is the plane on which the perspective is formed. The front view of perspective elements and of the object, if necessary, is also projected on this plane. Horizontal plane, HP.
This imaginary plane is at the level of the eye, that is the station point. It is a horizontal